So go ahead for people that just walked in, start on the warm-up problems, get your brain warmed up. What about first step for number one? What would be a good thing to do first? Kind of hinted at it initially. How would you take the derivative? Like, what would be the first thing to do in this case if it looks like elementary function or a combination thereof?
Separate inside and outside.
Well, that's actually what we're going to do moving forward. But we haven't quite learned how to take the derivative of composed functions. So we're just going to work with the techniques we have so far. And hopefully, when we do show you how to work with composed functions, the answer will end up being the same, right? And this is nice because some of these problems, then, you can approach with either rule, depending on what you know and what you feel comfortable with. Simplify. This is x plus 1 times x plus 1 times x plus 1. So use that. You know, if you want to jump to number 2 first, because that one looks easier for you, go for it. But just multiply out x plus 1 3 times. Any other worksheets that need to be passed in? Or pictures? Okay.
So I know this is a stupid question, but how do you feel about going back to like algebra for a second and showing how you got that real quick?
I am happy to do that if people want to see it. Okay, I'm happy to show you that.
Thank you.
There's also something called Pascal's Triangle that is a fun shortcut for a lot of these very special ones, all the way up to like, you know, for x plus 1 to the 10th, for example, if you're really interested in geeking out. But until then, So x plus 1 quantity cubed is all of, basically x plus 1 multiplied by itself 3 times. So the first thing I would do is I would start by just multiplying those two. And Dylan, do you follow the step to that one, or do you want to see that one too? I'm okay to do it.
I follow the step to that one.
Okay, so the squaring part is okay, right? This one we've seen quite a bit. Okay. So then you have to multiply a trinomial by a binomial. I'm becoming more and more in favor of using the box method, which basically helps you just keep track of your terms. I don't know if you guys have seen this before, but it just is a little bit nicer for keeping track of all your terms because there's a lot. Basically, every single one of these has to be paired with, you have to make every possible pairing between these three terms and these two terms. And so you end up with 6 different combinations, and sometimes you can lose track. So that's why I find box method pretty helpful. Okay. So this x squared times x is x cubed, 2x times x, 2x squared, x times 1 is x. X squared times 1 is just x squared. 2x times 1 is just 2x. Basically, it's itself on the end, right? Because you're just multiplying by 1, right? So, and what's also really helpful is that the terms are all organized. So when you're adding all of these together, ultimately, right? And these two are like terms, and these two are like terms, right? Those are the quotations. So that's the technical math definition, like terms. So when you add them together, you've got x cubed plus, and these two things, the coefficients add to 3, right? So you've got 3x squared plus 3x plus 1. So I recommend that method to help you sort out all possible combinations. Hopefully you've also seen this method utilized for binomials times binomials, like the ones p plus q times p plus q. This is the same method. Okay? That just helps you realize all the possible combinations. Therefore, you can extend this method to deal with trialeutic situations when you're calculating gene frequencies. If you are interested in geeking out on that, I can totally do that too. But Dylan, does that help?
It does.
Okay.
Yeah, have
people seen this method before for organizing their terms? A few of you, depending, not everybody. I think it's pretty helpful just because I'm a big fan of, if you take the time to organize your work a little better, the lesser chance you'll make a silly little mistake and then cascading errors after that. Okay. Okay. So if you get all the way to here, then you're taking the derivative. You'd be taking the derivative of each of those pieces. Okay, and I could have grouped these together in one, it doesn't matter. So derivative of x cubed. X squared. Y'all can say it in unison together because I know you guys know, right? So 3x squared, remember that the 3 can pull out, right? So you can multiply, oops, I did 3, not 2. So you have 3 times, so what's the derivative of x squared?
2x.
2x. Again, it's good practice to pull that 3 out, make sure you remember you're multiplying it. As you become more comfortable, you can just like take the 2 down and multiply by the 3 in all one step. But rather you have one too many steps now than one not too many. Derivative of 3x?
3.
Derivative of 1?
2.
Good job. Okay, so the derivative of y is 3x squared plus 6x plus 3. Okay. I'll do this one in line on the board because it doesn't take much space. This one, product rule, okay? So when we take the derivative, it's not a very dark marker. I'm trying to find something a little darker for you guys, sorry. That's not good either. One more. That's better. Okay. So product rule says that you should take turns taking the derivatives, right? Now, by coincidence, you know, they're the same thing, right, we've taken the derivative of. So, you know, and also by coincidence, if the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. So it doesn't really change it all that much. This becomes e to the x times e to the x plus e to the x times e to the x, which is 2 of the e to the x times e to the x terms, right, because we're adding same thing twice. So I can simplify a little bit more if I want. Really, I would be okay with this answer, but just for those who see the little extra simplification here, when you have the same base and you're multiplying, you add exponents, so you could write this as 2e to the 2x if you'd like to. Okay? So just in the interest of time, I'm going to skip the last one. If you wanted to, you could use that shortcut for 1 over something that's on your formula sheet. Otherwise, you can do this just via a quotient rule. But I just want to move along because I want to spend this much time talking about rules today so I can have this much time about the fun stuff, the reason why chain rule becomes so important. I'm gonna have to win it, right? Oh, okay. There we go. Okay. So this is where we left off last time. We were talking about that we need some way of dealing with things that are dealing with functions that are not elementary functions added or subtracted or multiplied or divided, but rather one function inside of another. Yes, you could do this by multiplying it all out. Wouldn't it be easier, however, if we just had a way to pull these apart quickly and then find the derivative more quickly? That would be ideal. So we already talked last class about identifying the elementary function pieces of these function compositions. And so we talked about the inner function, which is usually a thing in parentheses, or it's the first step of your function process. And the idea of an outer function, which is the second step of your function process, or maybe the third, depending. And it's usually what's left over after you replace, after you sort of call that the inner function. So that's always your first step. We've had a great worksheet that you all passed forward that goes over these steps. So here's how you use them to find a derivative. So what you do is you call the inner function u, call the outer function g. This is what I had you do on the worksheet. So that step should be okay. The next step is all you have to do is take the derivative of these two things and multiply the answer together. That's it. Few caveats, The structure of chain rule looks a lot like a product. Do not get this confused with product rule, okay? Be a little bit careful about that. Second thing, you will notice that this is in terms of U, and this is in terms of X. When we're all done, we will have to put our entire answer back in terms of X. So you gotta keep track of what that relationship is between U and X, okay? So, derivative of U cubed. Derivative of U cubed. Exactly. Derivative of X plus 1. So the answer I get is just 3u squared. Now I did say, like, if you have a function given to you in terms of x and you answer with 3u squared, that's gonna be like, wait a minute, where'd that come from, right? So you just have to put that back in. You already told me earlier that u was just x plus 1. So we, as a final answer, you have to write x plus 1 there instead of u. So the derivative is this. Does that match up? Well, turns out this is what we got down here, right? If I pull 3 out, like the way that is written, I'd have x squared plus 2x plus 1. So 3 times x squared plus 2x plus 1 is the same as 3 times x plus 1 squared, right? So this agrees. This does give us our answer. Again, you can find full proof of why this rule works for every situation. I won't do that in this class, but if you want to, if you're curious, I'll point you to the right resources to go through that. All I'm trying to do is at least provide you some anecdotal evidence that it does actually do what we say it will. Yeah.
Why does the 3u squared go back to 3 times x plus 1?
It's a matter of giving your final answer. Your original function is in terms of x. So your final answer should be in terms of x. And you, at the very first step, declared, made a new variable called u that was x plus 1. So that's all I'm using.
So
I'm just putting the x plus 1 back.
Will it always be u? Always, like,
I tend to use u to do my inner. If you don't want to find the hardest inner, that sounds very philosophical, but like, if you don't want to find your inner you, if you want to use a different letter, you can. Okay? So feel free. I'm not picky about that, but at least, you know, if I'm consistent in my letter labeling, then it's easier to follow for you guys. Okay? Any other questions or clarifications? The next slide in this just has what I did on the board, just in case you want to flip a reference. And what I did try to do in the slides is color code some things for you so that you would be able to follow. Yeah.
So you had said like the 3 times x plus 1 squared is just the same as the 3x squared plus 2x plus 1.
Mm-hmm.
Like if on a test, what would you preferred format to be?
I literally on the test, I'm okay if you leave it like this. The only time I'm really concerned about the simplifying is if you're trying to check your answer somehow. So like I couldn't tell necessarily that this was the same as this without doing a little simplification.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only time you really need it.
Would you like specify on the test if you wanted the chain rule done as opposed to just finding the derivative
that
way?
Yep. So I'll do something like, I'll say, here's a function. Use two different methods to solve. Or I'll say, use the product rule to do this. Like, or, you know, I'll just leave it open, and then you can pick whichever you want to do. If you want to do the limit definition of derivative, you could. I'm not I'm expecting you won't, but, and you know, that would be up to you. If I don't specify, you're free to choose, as long as you implement a proper one. Okay? So, let's try e to the 2x. So this is actually the other one that we had as an example. I wrote it as e to the 2x instead of e to the x times e to the x. So we kind of already know what the answer should be. And it looks a little bit like number 4 on your worksheet that was for homework. So what's the inner function? What's the inner? What's u? What's the inner u, guys? And how did you recognize that it was going to be 2x? Kind of imagine the parentheses up there. You might have maybe said, okay, what's the first step in the process? It's to multiply it first, right? Before you list it as an exponent. If you take this and you, instead of writing 2x, you replace it with u, that's your hour function. That's all you do, right?
You could never just write e.
Yeah, because e would imply that t is a constant, right? So it has to be a function of a variable. Okay. So chain rule then says to take the derivative of each and multiply them. So I have them in the reverse order, but it doesn't matter. So 2x times. Okay, you can do the rest from here, right? Go ahead and finish that off, and then compare with your neighbor. Terms of u, that'll also help you first identify whether it looks correctly. Yes.
will these always be like the inner function that we're bringing back? So is it always going to work out like that when you're working with that? Okay. Right.
There might be also some terms of x here that you won't need to worry about with one thing.
Okay.
But there should be almost always, I think, I'm trying to think of an example where u doesn't appear.
Like you would never have to change the outer or.
Yeah. No, you would. Okay. You'd only ever have to change
right.
the u. Yeah. Anything? Any other questions? These are good questions though, because you're making observations that you want to generalize. So that's
score.
Okay. So, in the spirit of generalizing observations. I think I kind of want to go there next. Let me just make a couple of quick notes before I move on to that discussion. There are instances in which you may have to employ more than one rule. Because we have sort of an in-class environment for our exams, I wouldn't want to totally overload you with like using more than one rule at a time. However, this kind of stuff might appear on an out-of-class assignment or something like that, your homework, et cetera. So I just want to mention it. If you have a situation like this, you can see that this isn't quite an elementary function. It's close. The derivative is not awful to take, but it's not quite elementary. And of course, there's a product in here too. So you would have to use both product rule and chain rule. So some good notation will help with this. So if this is why I say things like, okay, if you're gonna do the derivative, instead of just like running and starting to take derivatives of the pieces, just write it out first. Like, this is my intention, is to do this, okay? And then on the side, you can figure out, okay, well, this one isn't too bad. That one's pretty straightforward. But this one may take a little work, and you might have to implement chain rule. Now, one easy way of getting out of that work is to have a rule for some of these functions that you will see more often. And so I would like to spend the rest of my time talking about this particular function, because this is a pretty important function in life and environmental sciences, the exponential growth or decay function, depending on how you write it and what letters you use. So I think this is worth it enough to talk about the general formula for this case so that you don't have to use chain rule over and over again on it. Okay? Now if you forget it, you can use chain rule on it. But other than that, does that make sense? Two just in case somebody didn't want to leave me a little side hanging.
That's great.
Okay. So, I'm going to pass these out. I think I have enough here, and I didn't leave any more on my copier, but I'm going to take some on your side. Some on your side, and I'll put them back here. Let me just check the top of the room. The exponential function. And now again, one way that you might see the exponential function used is in continuous population growth, and in which case you probably see these letters associated with it. R is usually called an intrinsic growth rate, P is the population size, P sub zero is the initial population size at time t equals zero. Has everybody seen this before? Okay. In chemistry, you might see it with different letters. It's the same equational function. Okay. So there are two advantages to knowing these rules. One, if you know the algebraic rules, you can do things like generalize this so you don't have to write it over and over again. And two, if you generalize it, you won't have to write it over and over again, right? So that's why I'm going to spend some time. The third is because by understanding the derivative, you better understand why we use exponential functions. So that's really what I want to spend our time on talking about today. So when I take the derivative, note that P sub zero and R are constants, okay? So the thing that I'm treating the variable is T, okay? That's why we might say P is a function of T. T is the thing that I'm treating as the independent variable, okay? So because T naught is a constant, I can move it outside of these parentheses, correct? It only works when you're multiplying by a constant. And there's some space on these the worksheet that I just passed out to put all these. So, what's the inner function? What's the inner U? I'm sorry?
Ert.
Ert. Is it ERT or is it RT? RT.
Yes, one of those.
RT. RT, I hear a vote for RT. How many people think it's RT? How many people think the inner function is E to the RT? Nope. How many people have no clue? Okay, let's start there. So, when we were doing the derivative of E to the 2x, what was the inner function?
2x.
So given that, what might be the inner function in this case?
RT.
He wants it both ways. E to the RE or RT. Yeah. So if the inner function in this case is 2x, probably the inner function in this case is going to be RT. Okay. Because we're really not dealing with this anymore. We're just dealing with the derivative of e to the rt, right? So a couple of things that I want you to observe. First, if you're dealing with an equation with parameters and you're not really sure how to take the derivative because things look like variables even though you know they're supposed to be constants, write an example with constants next to it and think, what would I do if it looked like that? Okay, that's a great technique, and it'll be useful to you. The second is, again, to think about the process. You're having t as a variable, and the first thing you do to t is you multiply it by r, okay? So that should be the clue that the inner function here is just rt. There's only two steps in that function, multiplying it by r, and then raising it as an exponent to the e base. And so, as a result, the second one is the one that's going to be the outer function, the raising. The first one's going to be the inner, right? Here u is a function of t instead of the x's that we were doing before. And that's okay. And you replace RT by U. Now, again, I'm not dealing with P naught yet. Really, I'm just doing this part. This is all the side work
just for this part right here.
It wouldn't be like g of t equal eu, or why is it g of u?
Because I'm replacing the r to the u. So I'm trying to write it so that it looks like an elementary function.
Okay.
So now we just have to do the derivative of the pieces. So derivative of RT.
R.
Now it might seem weird, but if I said what is the derivative of 2t, you might say 2. So that's why the derivative of RT is R. What's the derivative of chi?
E
to the u, right. So that's it. In order to find the derivative, you multiply u prime times g prime, and you get r times e to the u. Again, you started with something in terms of t, so you do want to make sure you put that back. So now you put the t back, the rt, not before you take the derivative, but after you're done. The whole role of making that substitution is to make things look like elementary functions that you can take derivatives of easily. So you don't want to make that substitution back until you're done with that derivative. Okay, now that was just this piece right here. Let me just rewrite this now up here. So we said that the derivative of p, so the answer we got out of this was r e to the r t, right? Well, this is nice because so far we've established as a general rule, anytime we have a constant times our e to the 4x, e to the 2t, e to the whatever, the resulting answer is always the exponential function with the coefficient on the outside. It's a little bit like pull down rule, but I don't want you to get confused because we're not subtracting one, okay? And it's not the whole thing that comes down, it's just the coefficient. So if you want to add it to the bottom of your elementary functions list, you can. However, I'm not gonna stop there, I'm gonna rewrite this just slightly. Just because it looks better, first of all. Okay, so here's one. This one's a little bit more general. So this even says if you have a coefficient in the front, then you just multiply that r by the coefficient, right? So it's one step more of generality. So now you can do 4e to the 2x. So the derivative of 4 e to the 2x. Under this rule, like, could you use this rule? What does the answer look like? The answer looks like the 4e to the 2x times the coefficient of this thing. I'm trying to point this out only because if you kind of make these generalizations, it'll make your homework and your everything else a lot quicker, right? So if you are taking the derivative of this, the derivative looks like the thing you start with. This only works for exponential functions like this, okay? Times the coefficient of that exponent. You see that?
So you still have to put it in that dp over dt form before it's finalized, or?
Well, this just said that I actually took the derivative, right?
I guess I'm just a little lost from where you went from p initial times re to what's below it. Nope.
P prime is the same as DPDT. I just wrote the form, the notation differently. That's all I did.
I meant where the, right where your hand is, yeah, those two.
Yeah, these two, I just switched the order of these.
Okay.
The only reason I did that is so that you could tell that this is what we start with, because like, then they'd be grouped together.
Okay.
That's it. So in this case, the way we would do it is you would say, okay, well, this is what I started with, and then you multiply that by the coefficient in the exponent.
So fours were just an example of just to put it.
This is an example, yeah. Let me do another. Let me have you guys do another example because I think it would be helpful. So you had something like this, and you said find the derivative. Now, this isn't e to the t, these are the minus t, so we can't just jump and say the derivative is itself, right? But it's close. The derivative is itself times. Perfect. Because that's the coefficient of t there. Does that make sense? Hopefully this saves you a little bit of time and effort doing your common chain rule problems, because this function is one of the ones you use most commonly. Chain rule has to be used for most commonly. Okay. So I just want to save you a little bit of time here. Mm-hmm.
When you simplify that with the negative t become positive?
No. But the negative 1 times negative 5 could just be negative 5 e to the minus t. If you want to, you wouldn't have to.
Mm-hmm. Is this just because we're working with e?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this formula only works for things that look like this. Right. Chain rule you can use for a more wide variety of applications.
So
but,
is this still considered a chain rule?
So we used chain rule to get the general notation.
Okay. And would you have had to use this equation to get what we got, or is this just easier than using the chain rule?
In order to get this generalization, you had to use chain rule along the way. If you do it 100 times, you'll realize that this pattern occurs. And then you'll be able to use that pattern all the time. And that, of course, would be much faster than using chain rule all the time. I'm trying to give you a little bit of a shortcut to recognizing that pattern and using it. That's all. But know that it does come essentially from chain rule. Okay? This is a good one to add to your elementary functions list. I think this is one we'll use a lot. So it's worth it. Okay? Any other questions, clarifications? Okay. So now I'll go to why I actually care about this function so much beyond the fact that we use it a lot. So what I want to do is I want to start from that form. Just rewriting it so they're right one on top of the other so that we can see them very carefully. Okay. And really what I said is, but this right here was the original thing that you started with, which is p, right? Okay. So far, so good?
is, again, I'll repeat it again, the rate, the derivative is r times p, what you started with originally. Why am I so obsessed with the natural exponential rate? Why did I just spend 45 minutes on it? Because this is the most important part. When we are using the exponential function, what we're saying is we're using a function that really means that the rate of change of the population size is proportional to the population size itself. Okay? The rate of change is proportional to the current size. So if things get bigger, the rate of change gets even bigger, and you get exponential growth, right? As a population drops, as the population gets smaller, the rate of change gets smaller and it asymptotes out to zero, right? So this can also be represented, sometimes like this, because the population size itself feeds itself. The rate of change gets bigger as the population size gets bigger, and it creates what we call a feedback loop. And you might be familiar with this from an audio perspective, right? It gets louder, the speaker picks it up, it makes the screech even louder, right? And so when we're talking about things that are modeled well by the exponential function, we're talking about things that probably as an underlying process have a feedback loop mechanism. So it tells us something really, really important about the change occurring in the system. And then it may also tell us something really important about managing that change, about what will happen if the change isn't managed. And so we just saw in our first project part that carbon dioxide concentrations were well modeled by an exponential function. So what does that mean for the system? It means that there is some underlying mechanism that once you start getting bigger, it feeds into itself. So it's not just a matter of it getting bigger, but that bigness is enhanced through these feedback loops. Has anybody heard about feedback loops before in other contexts or classes? What's another class or context that you might have heard about them?
Anatomy.
I'm sorry?
Human anatomy.
So give me an example of...
Like a negative feedback loop is like insulin with sugar, and they like level each other up, but there's like very few positive feedback loops with like hormones and stuff.
So like homeostasis takes negative feedback loops, right? And if you have positive feedback loops, those are things that...
Just going.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes to describe sort of this trend, we call it a positive feedback loop in a negative direction, right? As opposed to a negative feedback loop, right? Just, the negative direction of that huge change. This is, if you remember back when we were talking about discrete growth models, the geometric model, which is the discrete analog of this continuous process, had a very similar story with it. Remember that? So that lambda, instead of using the intrinsic growth rate r, we had a lambda. And we said that the next generation is lambda times the previous. So we knew that the previous generation was somehow determining through some proportionality what the next would look like, right? Very similar story. Both processes act very similarly. And there's a relationship between lambda and r approximately, that e to the r is approximately lambda. Okay. Questions? Okay. So the difference, one of the differences, and this sort of comes from the fact that e to the r is kind of acting like lambda here, is that you get differences in behavior, real long-term behavior, not when r is greater than 1 or less than 1, like it is with lambda, but rather when r is positive or r is negative. And if you reflect back, you realize, oh, that's right, when I have a negative here, that's exponential decay, right? And if that's a positive, then it's exponential growth, right? So these kinds of functions, e to the 5, e to the minus t, look like this, right? And these kinds of functions that have a positive exponent look like this, okay? So you can do very much the same kind of reasoning in talking about long-term outcomes for these populations that you can do when you're talking about geometric growth. Again, it's all about the differences between the two. There's this difference, first of all. So you have to recognize, am I in a discrete context or am I in a continuous? Because something like your parameter being 0.5 has a very different meaning depending on your context, okay? But we can talk about things like long-term growth. We can talk about things like equilibria and stability, okay? So in the continuous context, we don't have a next generation size, so we couldn't talk about equilibrium. So equilibrium we kind of have to deal with in a slightly different way. It still means no change, but we can't compare consecutive generations, right? Because in a continuous context, there are not a next generation, right? So no change means that the derivative is zero, okay? So when we talk about equilibria, it's our value of p such that the derivative is zero. So in our context, dp, dt, rp, the value of p that makes that true is, in order for rp to be true, to be zero, p has to be what? What number? Zero, right? That might not be any surprise that the equilibrium in the continuous context is the same as the discrete context for geometric growth, right? Equilibrium is zero. If all solutions go towards zero, right? And that would require that your exponent be less than, that your coefficient of your exponent be less than zero. In this case, the population itself, we might not use the qualitative descriptor that is stable. But what you're saying is that zero, as an equilibrium, it's stable because everything is going towards zero. So this would be that negative feedback loop, that thing that leads and reinforces homeostasis. And it's unstable. Solutions go away from zero if the exponent is positive. I know you're no stranger to exponential functions, right? This is a different perspective on exponential functions that actually gets at mechanisms and processes that you don't really get to when you're just talking about exponential functions as in the, like a pre-calculus context, because we don't have a language to talk about how something is changing yet, right? This becomes a really important topic, especially when we're dealing with things like climate change. Any questions? questions on this interpretation or this new sort of framework for thinking about exponential functions?
So sort of like the geometric equations, except it's zero instead of one.
Yeah. A lot of it is very, very similar. They're analogs to each other. And the big difference is sort of this. So if r is zero, length is one, right? Any other questions? So the worksheet that you have, most of it is taken care of by these steps here. It's more guided to have you come up with some of these insights sort of on your own if it were an in-class activity that we're spending all class on. But on the flip side, there is an extra credit problem, and so I invite you to try it out if you'd like to. It is a challenge problem, okay? It means that I think the stuff that I just did in class brings me like halfway down the first side of the sheet. And then you get to expand on that to some more complicated things. And again, it's a challenge problem, okay? And if you can do this, you could do like any question on the exam, okay? So I just wanted to throw it out there. This sort of gets at another function that I think is important to talk about, which is the exponential growth function. I'm sorry, the logistic growth function. So those are the two primary differential equations. This form is called a differential equation. Derivative, you can see, it comes from the same word, differential equation. That function, exponential growth and logistic growth are like two of the basic building blocks of ecological dynamics. So Pop and Tom, you might have heard them throw out a little bit. Many people have heard logistic growth before. Okay, yeah, right? And there's probably some pretty ugly function associated with logistic growth, right? I think it's on the second part, the backside of this function at the top, right? Or we'll see, it is, yeah, so the fraction kp naught over that thing, right? And you always looked at it and you were like, why is that exponential growth? Like some person took that out of the air, like it looks like an s, that's why we use it, right? No, there's a lot of other functions that look like s's. Why do we use that one? So I won't give you all the steps to do the extra credit. What I'll do is I'll talk about the punchline of it, just so that you see why we're talking about it at all, or why I invited you to participate in that process. I think I had in terms of P's. I can't remember if I had terms of P's or N's in that one. You might see it in terms of N instead of P in class. So it turns out that ugly rational expression with stuff on the top and bottom is the same as this differential equation. Okay, so let's talk about what this differential equation means in terms of underlying mechanisms. And this is why it's so exciting to me. Exciting for me, hopefully for you a little bit. Exciting to really understand why we're spending the time developing this idea of instantaneous rate of change. I made Gunther smile. I'm so glad he's smiling again. Okay, so, right? Because he laughed. Everybody's laughing a little bit, right? Okay. She helped herself. Okay, so this is what it really tells you. This is why we're using it, okay? We're not using it because it's an arbitrary S function. There's an actual meaning behind it. So the first thing, let me just rewrite this slightly. All I did is I distributed the RP in. That's all I did. I didn't mess around with anything else, okay? And remember how we talked about the rate of change? It was like the rate of things coming in versus the rate of things going out, minus, okay? This is how the carbon dioxide concentration problem was framed, right? So let's talk about the factors that are coming in to population growth when we're thinking about logistic populations, logistically growing populations. So what's that? It's exponential growth, right? And if we remember the meaning of exponential growth, yeah, it's this feedback loop, but if we remember that it's analogous to geometric, why did we get those feedback loops? Why did that behavior happen? Why would you have change proportional to your current size? It's probably because breeding, right? So the number of breeding animals is proportional to your current population. So this is that intrinsic growth. This is that natural birth-death process, okay? So things are getting added to your population in a natural birth-death process way. Hopefully more births than deaths, maybe, okay? How are things... how are things leaving? This is how things are leaving your population, okay? Things are leaving your population through intraspecific competition. So that P square term means that you have P times P. So your individuals are interacting with each other, okay? That's intraspecific competition. They're interacting with each other for some resource. And this term sort of describes the balance between the intrinsic growth rate, the amount of new individuals that are getting added, offspring, et cetera, that are competing, and the competition for a fixed amount of resources around that. K being that carrying capacity, how much your environment can really hold. So how fast are you growing versus how much can you hold, right? So this is... so we use that ugly formula for logistic growth because what we're saying is that this particular population grows in such a way that has some intrinsic birth-death process growing the population. But you have a pressure on the population for a fixed amount of resources and intraspecific competition towards reproduction for that fixed amount of resources. Okay? So there's a storyline that goes with this ugly function. Now, in this class, I wouldn't give you this function and ask you to back solve for P somehow, right, to get that ugly function, right? That's a subject matter we can leave for Calc 2 for those who take Calc 2. But what I can do is I can give you that ugly function, and you can take the derivative and show that it's the same thing as this, okay? And the ugly function derivative, you have all of the tools to do that already. You may not know it, you may not realize it, but it takes a little bit of comfortability taking derivatives, with working with parameters, it takes a little bit of quotient rule, it takes a little bit of taking derivatives of things that look like that, okay? But you have all of the tools you really need to do it. Questions, clarifications about logistic growth. How many people thought that it was like some random S function that people used that had no meaning other than it was an S? Yeah, come on, admit it, right? So I think the power behind human calculus helps you understand the assumptions of the model at hand. Now, I'll tell you that moving forward, the second part of the project, so that will be starting on Tuesday, so don't forget to be here with your laptops Tuesday. So that second part of the project, the kind of population we're going to be investigating is a logistically growing population, okay? And we're gonna look really carefully at how that population is growing and how the rates of change are very different or similar to, in some instances, exponential growth, okay? So I wanna prime that discussion a little bit and get us ready for that discussion. It'll certainly be easier if you sort of read the project before class, because again, there's sort of a preamble that goes with it that talks about it. But I'll give you a little sort of verbal glimpse into what that looks like. So for environmental indicators, the first part looked at exponential growth of carbon dioxide levels. The second part looks more specifically at coral reef issues. And there was a paper that came out about coral reef resilience, and one of the things that they were talking about was the role of parrotfish in grooming coral and keeping it free of some algae, and how that, if you manage a parrotfish population, that it could help coral reefs. Manage it in a positive way. Well, what's happening is there was overfishing in the area, and so it was reducing the groomers, the algae was sort of overtaking the coral more than it should, and so if you raise the parrotfish population, lead them to a place of recovery, then they could potentially help out so there's not additional stressors on the coral. Does that storyline make sense? Okay. So this data and comes from a study that they did on parrotfish recovery. And so we're gonna be looking at that particular data and look at what that looks like, or what that's projected to look like for this parrotfish population. In terms of the mathematics of this, when you're examining, I don't think it'll kill anybody's, it'll be any spoiler to say that the function looks like that, right? Hopefully that's what you get tomorrow when you graph P, okay, as a starting place for your population analysis. Everybody knew that, right? Logistic graph, right? Okay. Okay. P is the axis. Okay. So when you're in this region here, okay, very small population sizes. If you are very, very small, imagine P being close to zero, okay? This term right here is negligible. It means it doesn't play a huge role. So this very much looks a lot like exponential growth. You see that? Okay. If P is very large, you know, as large as it can be, close to K, okay? If P is close to K, this term becomes more like 1, correct? P over K, P is close to K, looks like K over K, looks like 1, right? So you'd have 1 minus 1 here, right? So this would be close to 0. You see that? So the rate of change should be close to 0 out here. Yeah? Okay. So while it behaves initially a lot like the exponential growth function, long term, it should have a very different behavior. And hopefully, you'll examine enough time steps, you may have to go out beyond sort of the initial 20 that you did for the first part, so that you can actually see this part of the behavior. Okay. And you'll be sort of, again, hopefully you'll see those comparisons between the way that it's similar to exponential growth, but the way that it's different as well. And I think this is also important because it leads us to really think about what it means when something's increasing. It's not enough anymore. When we're dealing in linear functions, we can just say increasing or decreasing, and we knew a lot about the population, but this is not linear anymore. And so if you say increasing, increasing exponentially is very different than increasing logistically. And so it's just not enough. We need more. And these tools, developing the concept of a derivative, give us the ability to talk about more. Okay? So that's sort of a preview of where we're going next class. So make sure you bring your laptops, your work ethic, I don't know, whatever, bring whatever else you need. But we'll be doing that, we'll start writing on that on Tuesday. Okay? Questions, clarification, you good? Okay, well, I will let you go 5 minutes early if you're okay with that. Promise to work hard.